Lord Jesus, the only way it can be well is through you. Yes. What a beautiful song. Yes. Lord, I pray that you would meet people where they are this morning. Those who are on the rebound of encouragement, those who seem to be on a sliding hill toward discouragement, those who are in recovering health, those who are in peril with their health, those who are spiritually bold, those who are spiritually adrift. By the end of the service today, give us that assurance of your Holy Spirit. Meet those who don't know you. Draw them to yourself, so that when we leave here, we can all say from the deepest depths, it is well with my soul. And God's people said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
And if you have any visitors today, I'm Ben, one of the elders, also our worship director. Have the privilege of preaching about once a month. And as we build the calendar for the year of the preaching that we're going to do, as you know, our main diet is expository preaching. We go through books of the Bible. And this year we have 7 or 8 slots where we just put a little pause in, a little break, so that if James or Mark or myself feel especially drawn towards a given text or topic, then we have an opportunity to explore that. It gives us a little bit of liberty. So this morning, that's what we're doing, and we'll return to Romans next week. This morning we'll be in the first 3 chapters of Revelation, specifically Revelation 2 and 3. So I'm going to start us off 105 years ago, June 24, 1914. An express train from Oxford to Worcester makes an unscheduled stop at a tiny village. On board is British poet, essayist, and novelist Edward Thomas. He was on his way to visit his friend, the poet Robert Frost, who many of you might have heard of, near Ledbury. Thomas always kept a notebook with him to record observations about the life and nature that were around him. And after stopping for just a minute, the train eventually started back up again. But that little slice of time when it was stopped, and Thomas's observations about that, became the impetus for one of the most famous and beloved British poems of the 20th century. Let's listen to it.
Yes, I remember Adlestrop, the name. Because one afternoon of heat, the express train drew up there, unwontedly. It was late June. The steam hissed. Someone cleared his throat. No one left, and no one came on the bare platform. What I saw was Adlestrop. Only the name. And willows, willow herb, and grass, and meadow sweet, and haycocks dry, no whit less still and lonely fair than the high cloudlets in the sky. And for that minute, a blackbird sang close by, and round him, mistier, farther and farther, all the birds of Oxfordshire and Gloucestershire.
English professor John Mann explains that the secret of Thomas's poem lies in the singular uneventfulness of what it describes. describes the beauty of the English countryside and the flora and fauna there in very matter-of-fact terms. Thomas had taken up poetry relatively late in life, having tried his hand at being a reviewer and also a critic. It was the American poet Robert Frost who encouraged Thomas to give poetry a go. And one of the other reasons for the poem's popularity lies in the date on which that unscheduled stop occurred. June 24th, 1914 is just 6 weeks before the outbreak of World War I. Adelstrop describes the England of sunny innocence before August 1914, when the First World War would change everything. And the reason this poem came to my mind for this sermon is that it describes a moment before irrevocable change, the calm before the storm. And it's where I would like our minds to be as much as possible before today's text changes us. So in a way, we're also sitting at that quiet train station. And the train tracks in front of us, they split off in these 7 different directions. And by the end of my message, hopefully you'll see yourself on one of these tracks, or maybe you're like, I'm a mixture of some of those. Revelation, as Pastor James said, was penned toward the end of the first century by John, who Jesus referred to as the Beloved. It contains challenge and hope and triumph and some of the most encouraging and wildly symbolic and joyful and fearsome words and images in your whole Bible. So if you wouldn't mind, if you could grab the Bible in front of you, please, and turn to the book of Revelation, the very first chapter. Verses 1 through 4. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear and who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. John, to the 7 churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the 7 spirits who are before his throne. And God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. So John explains that the immediate audience for this letter is the 7 churches of Asia. So here's a map of the 7 churches drawn by Clarence Larkin. You might remember him from 2 Thessalonians. He's that Bible artist and chart maker that I showed you guys then. If we close in a little bit, you'll see that all the 7 churches that are mentioned when we're talking about the 7 churches of Asia are all actually in what's considered modern day Turkey. Now, let's continue reading. If you still have your Bibles, you can follow along. It's also going to be on the screen. And listen to the word of God as Jesus shares very specific messages for the 7 churches in chapters 2 and 3.
To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the 7 stars in his right hand, who walks among the 7 golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent, and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you, and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Yet this you have. You hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last, who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. And to the angel of the church in Pergamum write, the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. Yet you hold fast my name, and you did not deny my faith, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel, so that they might eat food sacrificed to idols and practice sexual immorality. So also you have some who hold the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Therefore repent. If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, the words of the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire, and whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your works, your love and faith and service and patient endurance, and that your latter works exceed the first. But I have this against you, that you tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, and is teaching and seducing my servants to practice sexual immorality and to eat food sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to repent, but she refuses to repent of her sexual immorality. Behold, I will throw her onto a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her I will throw into great tribulation unless they repent of her works, and I will strike her children dead. And all the churches will know that I am he who searches mind and heart, and I will give to each of you according to your works. But to the rest of you in Thyatira, who do not hold this teaching, who have not learned what some call the deep things of Satan, to you I say, I do not lay on you any other burden. Only hold fast what you have until I come. The one who conquers and who keeps my works until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, as when earthen pots are broken in pieces, even as I myself have received authority from my Father. And I will give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, the words of him who has the 7 spirits of God and the 7 stars. I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. Remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come against you. Yet you still have a few names in Sardis, people who have not soiled their garments, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. The one who conquers will be clothed thus in white garments, and I will never blot his name out of the book of life. I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the words of the Holy One, the true One, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word, and have not denied my name. Behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you. Because you have kept my word about patient endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world, to try those who dwell on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have, so that no one may seize your crown. The one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. Never shall he go out of it, and I will write on him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments, so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes, so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and eat with him and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
And all God's people said,
Amen.
While we let that text settle in on us, I wanted to chart our course this morning in your notes, in your handout, by highlighting the truths that we learn about Jesus in these messages to the seven churches in Asia, and you can fill in the blanks as we go along. First one, in his message to the church in Ephesus, we learn that Jesus hates. Yet this you have, he says, you hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. We don't know much about the Nicolaitans. Most scholars' best guess is that what they were espousing was a mix of idolatry and sexual immorality. But here we have Jesus saying explicitly that he hates something. And here we need to realize that as the Son of God, as the second person in the Holy Trinity, not only does Jesus hate some things, but if he didn't hate them, he would cease to be what he is. And Jesus' hate arises out of his love for the glory of God the Father. It arises out of his righteousness, out of his holiness, and his love of truth. Now, human hate, as opposed to divine, is often sullied with an admixture of poor motivations and a heart that's not 100% right. But that we should have a holy hatred that aligns with Scripture, I want to make sure we understand. God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are perfectly unified in what they hate. Speaking through Isaiah, God says, "For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrong." When he speaks through Zechariah, he says, "Do not devise evil in your hearts against one another, and love no false oath. For all these things I hate, declares the Lord." Speaking through the Old Testament prophet Amos, the Lord goes right at the hypocrisy of the Israelites. Now listen to how you would feel if you were on the receiving end of this. The Lord tells you, "I hate, I despise your feasts. I take no delight in your solemn assemblies." That's sobering. And Moses warns the Israelites before they enter the promised land. He says to the assembled people, "You shall not worship the Lord your God in that way." Now, that way is the way of the pagan, unbelieving Canaanites. "For every abominable thing that the Lord hates, they have done for their gods. For they even," listen to this, "burn their sons and their daughters in the fire to their gods." Jesus hates. And the Bible is our guide to get us on the same page as far as holy hatred. But handle it with care, and always pray earnestly that your zealousness for what is right and good will not be hampered by your own sin. We always have to guard against that. In his message to the church in Smyrna, we learn that Jesus tests. He says, "Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested. And for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." Now, history is full of examples of individuals that the book of Revelation suggests will be at the head of the line at the end of time, receiving their crown and honor from Jesus because they've endured the most extreme suffering and pain for the glory of his name. You might remember those famous lines from Hebrews chapter 11 when James was preaching on it. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy. That's a great line. Wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. Some of you might have heard of the famous Book of Martyrs written by John Fox. Fox's Book of Martyrs, penned in the 16th century, I believe. And honestly, there are some descriptions in there that I really can't even go into this morning because they're so intense and disturbing as far as what people have suffered for Jesus Christ. But they all died clinging to Jesus' promise of the crown of life. And he is not going to fail any one of those people that died giving glory to his name. Amen?
Amen.
In his message to the church in Pergamum, we learn that Jesus wars. "Therefore repent," he says. "If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth." Jesus says he will war. The Bible tells us Jesus wars. Who or what does he war against? He wars against evil. He wars against Satan. He wars against demons. He wars against death. In fact, the decisive victory against the devil, his demons, death, and sin was won 2,000 years ago on Calvary in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's why John Owen, remember him, he wrote a book on the atonement Jesus provided on the cross with the somewhat convoluted but accurate title, "The Death of Death in the Death of Christ." And our Bible tells us the full and final effects of that victory will come to fruition at the end of time. So how do you enlist in Jesus' army? How do you make sure you're on the right team? Jesus tells us in the first two words of the verse, "Therefore, repent." On October 31st, 1517, Martin Luther nailed those 95 theses to the Wittenberg door in Germany and launched a whole conflagration that turned into the Protestant Reformation. Thesis number one is very important. Number one of 95. When our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, "Repent," he intended that the entire life of believers should be repentance. That's number one. In his message to the church in Thyatira, we learn that Jesus is a king who gives authority. He's a king who gives authority. Verse 26, "The one who conquers and who keeps my works until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, as when earthen pots are broken in pieces, even as I myself have received authority from my Father. Now let's go back to our Bibles again, if you would open to Revelation 20, because this is a foreshadowing of what's happening in Revelation 20. And we're just going to read Revelation 20, verse 4. Revelation 20, verse 4. Then I saw thrones, this is John speaking, and seated on them were those to whom the authority to judge was committed. Also, I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. I am delighted that in the future, I am going to stand and salute as my generals in the faith, brothers and sisters who were beheaded by a guillotine 400 years ago, were shot by a North Korean bullet 10 years ago, were eaten by lions 1,800 years ago. I am happy that they're in front of the line ahead of me, and they are going to be the generals that Jesus gives authority to as the faithful to the uttermost. I'm going to give them authority in the new heavens and the new earth. And I am happy to be a private in that army. Now, Christ is no mere king. He's no mere prince. Listen to the Prince of Preachers, Charles Spurgeon, who had an amazing, any of you who are not familiar, I highly recommend his two-volume biography put out by Banner of Truth. Charles Spurgeon had an incredible life and was blessed greatly of God to have an incredible ministry. Thousands of people mourned when he passed. He really had the first mega church, several thousand people each week, no microphone, just the power of his voice, and people week after week after week under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. He turned London upside down. This is from the very last sermon he preached. He says, "Depend upon it, you will either serve Satan or Christ, either self or the Savior. You will find sin, self, Satan, and the world to be hard masters. But if you wear the livery of Christ," livery is a special uniform that's worn by a servant or official. "If you wear the livery of Christ, you will find him so meek and lowly of heart that you will find rest unto your souls. He is the most magnanimous of captains. There never was his like among the choicest of princes. He is always to be found in the thickest part of the battle. When the wind blows cold, he always takes the bleak side of the hill. The heaviest end of the cross lies ever on his shoulders. And if he bids us carry a burden, he carries it also. If there is anything that is gracious, generous, kind, and tender, yea, lavish, and superabundant in love, you always find it in him. These 40 years and more have I served him, blessed be his name, and I have had nothing but love from him. And I would be glad to continue yet another 40 years in the same dear service here below, if it so pleased him. His service is life, peace, joy. Oh, that you would enter on it at once. God help you to enlist under the banner of Jesus even this day." And then he says, amen. In his message to the church in Sardis, we learn that Jesus warns. "Remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief. You will not know at what hour I will come against you. Now this rings true. We're going to go in our Bibles one more time to the Gospel of Luke to hear our Savior's words from chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. This isn't something that wildly different than Jesus said when he was among the disciples several decades earlier before John received this vision. So Luke chapter 12, verses 1 through 9. In the meantime, when so many thousands of the people had gathered together that they were trampling one another, he began to say to his disciples first, "Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whatever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you have whispered in private rooms shall be proclaimed on the housetops. I tell you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body, and after that have nothing more that they can do. But I will warn you whom to fear. Fear him who, after he has killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? And not one of them is forgotten before God. Why, even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not. You are of more value than many sparrows. And I tell you, everyone who acknowledges me before men, the Son of Man also will acknowledge before the angels of God. But the one who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God." And then verse 35, he says, "Stay dressed for action and keep your lamps burning. And be like men who are waiting for their master to come home from the wedding feast, so that they may open the door to him at once when he comes and knocks. Blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at table, and he will come and serve them. And if he comes in the second watch or in the third and finds them awake, blessed are those servants. But know this, that if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have left his house to be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Jesus warns. In his message to the church in Philadelphia, we learn that Jesus rescues. "Because you have kept my word," verse 10 says, about patient endurance, "I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to try those who dwell on the earth." Are you among those whom Jesus has rescued? If you're not, why not? What happens when we've surrendered to Christ's rescue mission? Let's listen to the great Matthew Henry. "All who by the grace of God are rescued from under the power of the father of lies and are disposed to receive the truth and submit to the power and influence of it will hear Christ's voice, will become his subjects, and will bear faith and true allegiance to him. Everyone that has true faith belongs to his kingdom. By the power of truth, he makes them willing. All that are in love with truth will hear the voice of Christ, for greater, better, surer, sweeter truths can nowhere be found than are found in Christ, by whom grace and truth came, so that by hearing Christ's voice, we know that we are of the truth. It's almost like Spurgeon and Henry are worshiping the same God. And lastly, a word of encouragement for those of you who find yourselves in desperate circumstances. The word rescue appears in the English Standard Version 18 times in the Psalms. The Psalms are a balm and a gift from God for his people. They're the songbook of Jesus. And they are a ready resource when you're at wit's end. You will not find darker depths than David and some of the other authors visited. God allowed them to go the deepest before pulling them out. Why? So they could sing songs of praise and thanksgiving to a God who rescues.
Yes.
There are times that we're fooling ourselves. Here's a downside. And we don't want to be rescued. Right after I graduated from SPU, I worked at a Domino's Pizza on Queen Anne Hill in Seattle. And I was friends with the manager there, and there was a local homeless gent that we befriended who was about our age, but looked about 15 or 20 years older because of, you know, how life had not gone well for him, and he struggled with alcohol. And in fact, he slept under one of the bridges on Queen Anne Hill. And so we befriended him, and he would do some work around the pizza store, and we would pay him a little bit under the table. I don't know if the IRS was totally fine with that, but I'm okay. I'll plead my case when I get to heaven as far as that's concerned. To try to help him out a little, give him a little bit so that he would have sustenance. And the manager of the Domino's, through a friend of a friend, was able to secure him a job as a dishwasher for a restaurant in Bellevue. So everything was lined up, the new job was ready, transportation was arranged, he could get there on public transit. And everything was lined up. So he's going to go from under the bridge to an apartment, a job where he can have some self-satisfaction. And it's a nice restaurant. And they said, there's just one thing. We do have a dress code. And so we're going to need you to shave the beard. Obviously, it's not a surprise that as a struggling homeless guy, he had a pretty scraggly appearance and scraggly beard. And he said, no. I'm not gonna shave a beard. And we were flabbergasted. We were like, this opportunity was laid out for you on a silver platter, and you're refusing to be rescued. So that was a cautionary tale to me. Everything was teed up for this guy to get out of the spiritual, mental, and literal ditch that he was in. And he said, no. I'm not going to shave the beard. So, when you pray to God for rescue, when I pray to God for rescue, always include this little addendum. Lord, make me willing to be rescued. Okay? If my blindness or stubbornness is in the way, help me and get it out of the way. Be willing to be rescued. And in his message to the church in Laodicea, we learn that Jesus disciplines. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Now, I have a distant, long deceased relative whose leadership of his family, I'm sad to say, was really marked by cruelty and despotism. And when his children heard the word discipline, I'm sure well into their adult life, that had a highly negative connotation, probably made them flinch, because there was anything but loving discipline from this guy. But godly discipline is absolutely critical. And it's one of the chief responsibilities of families and of churches. Octavius Winslow was a minister in both America and England in the 1800s. And he's right on point here. He said, divine love chastens. Now, chasten is a synonym for discipline. It means essentially the same thing. Divine love chastens because it sees the necessity for the correction. The Lord's love is not a blind affection. It is all-seeing and heart-searching. When has he ever shown himself blind to the follies of his people? When has his love been ignorant of their sinful departures? Was he blind to the deception of Jacob? He chastened him for it. Was he blind to the impatience of Moses? He chastened him for it. Was he blind to the self-applause of Hezekiah? He chastened him for it. Was he blind to the adultery and murder of David? He chastened him for it. Was he blind to the idolatry of Solomon? He chastened him for it. It is our mercy as believers to know that, listen to this, love and not justice, grace and not vengeance, holds the rod and administers the correction. That's the standing we're in when we're believers. The rod is there, but the love behind it is incalculable. And Winslow's right. As many times as we might read that verse, there's never going to be a might there. Jesus doesn't say he might reprove and discipline. He says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. And note also in this verse to the Laodiceans that Jesus pairs zealousness and repentance together as the heartbeat of the Christian life. To those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Thomas Manton was one of the leaders of the 17th century Westminster Assembly that we talked about at Advent. And he says that to be zealous in our good works, listen to this phraseology, we ought to use diligence and earnestness to the highest pitch. And he asks rhetorical questions, Manton does. Like, what do you mean be a little charitable? What do you mean worship a little? What do you mean gather sometimes with the saints? He says sloth and idleness will not stand with zeal. What does he mean by that? He's saying when you put two magnets together, with the same polarity facing each other, they want nothing to do with each other, right? You've tried that. We were all kids. Try to put them together when the polarity faces, and you're like, it doesn't work. And godly zeal wants nothing to do with godless sloth and idleness. There's a wonderful phrase he uses when describing zeal. He says, zeal is when you're seething hot in spirit. Now, by comparison, he says, consider how violent, remember I talked about holy violence a few sermons ago, consider how violent and earnest or how zealous carnal men are in the ways of sin. Let's watch a short video.
Thank you.
So that burglar broke into our church almost exactly 2 years ago. And in the space of 5 minutes, he made off with the keyboard that we had and the light board, which controls all the lighting on the stage and in the sanctuary. 5 minutes from the first hammer on the window until he was done. And obviously, as you can see, we had a Wi-Fi camera that where you could hear and see what was going on, but we weren't able to identify who that was. This is what Manton's getting at. Consider that thief. Consider that person undertaking in the cover of darkness what he knew to be evil. He was girded for the task. He wore the proper attire that would disguise his identity. He had a headlamp on to give some light to his dark deed. He reviewed the plan and knew what it took to execute it. He had either visited our church or observed it enough so that he knew what to expect as far as our alarms and security were concerned. He made sure to be rested and ready for a 3 a.m. job. And from the first strike till he was gone was 5 minutes. That's why Manton says, Christian, consider, you have a better master, better work, and better wages. Their master is the devil. Their work is the basest drudgery, being slaves to their own lusts. And their wages are suitable. Their reward is everlasting damnation and a separation from the presence of the Lord. How active, he says, are wicked men for the kingdom of darkness. How zealous and earnest to ruin themselves, as if they could not be damned soon enough. And then Manton drops the microphone with this rhetorical question that pierces me. Shall they serve Satan better than you serve God? Today's text, chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, concludes with Jesus saying, for the seventh and final time, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Will we listen? I mentioned at the beginning of today's message that Edward Thomas had conceived of his Adlestrop poem on the way to visit his friend, the noted poet Robert Frost. Now, Frost returned to New Hampshire in 1915, and he mailed an advanced copy of The Road Not Taken to Thomas. Many of you are probably familiar with that, The Road Not Taken. You probably had to read it in grade school. And Frost intended The Road Not Taken as a gentle mockery of his friend Thomas, who could at times display indecisiveness. However, it had a much more dramatic, galvanizing effect on Thomas than Frost anticipated. Although he was 37 years old, living a comfortable life with a wife and 3 children, Thomas enlisted with the British Army to do his part by serving his country in the Great War. And surely included in the back of Thomas's mind when thinking of his country was that serene scene at Adlestrop. And Thomas, in his mind's eye, could see the allegorical train tracks coming out of that village, see that they split into multiple paths, and he chose one, decisively, leaving home and hearth for the infantry. On April 9th, 1917, in the first day of the Battle of Arras, France, on the Western Front, Thomas was killed in action. Forever in the hearts of his countrymen, not only for his prose, but also for his personal valor. A passenger train, a brief stop in a quiet village, a poem from a friend, and a course of action. And like I said, we're all leaving Adlestrop this morning. Which track are you on? Does it terminate at a dead end? Is the bridge out ahead? My prayer for us today is that all of us, everyone in this room, ends up on the track that's heading toward what another British author, C.S. Lewis, called the broad, sunlit uplands that never end. Amen? Amen?